Welcome to Magic Cat. Not often we get this, is it? Yeah. Glad to see you all. And
thank you.
We're just going to carry on with Jack, who's going to tell us why the world's flat, or how the world's flat, which is going to be an interesting talk, I think. Anyway, I'll pass you over to him. And
thank you, Robert. And thank you all for coming. It's an absolute pleasure. It's a crazy story, to be fair. It's a crazy story, but I have the privilege of building on the work of many, many great men here. And I'm not necessarily a deep scientist myself, just a layman, journalist, reporter. But I come to thoroughly believe that I do indeed live on a flat plane. And the stars are close, the sun and the moon are close. So a little bit of like my story of how I got there through Facebook and YouTube. Standard. And tonight's presentation will be largely borrowed from a good friend of mine in Spain. So he did a very similar presentation. And allowed me to use his slides from his presentation he did in Glastonbury. So a lot of respect to Mark Knight and waykiwayki research. And it's difficult to know where to start, really. So I'm going to start with a little introduction to this guy under the pen name as Parallax. His name was Samuel Rowbotham. And he did the bulk of the science in the 1840s, 1850s. This was published in 1862 to prove, indeed, through zetetic inquiry, that the Earth is flat and is a plane. And mostly the modern flat Earth movement of the last few years has really just repeated his experiments and found them to be true. And has had, you know, only a few more things to build on. We've got this weather balloon footage more easily accessible today. We've got better cameras, we've got better zoom lenses. But nothing that really anyone's found out in the last few years has gone far beyond what Rowbotham was saying 150 years ago, lecturing up and down England. Quite an incredible fellow, quite an incredible text, a very learned text. Been thoroughly enjoying this book. And it was him really that started using this word zetetic inquiry and the zetetic scientific method, which is basically science as we do perceive it, as we've been taught it, which is through inquiry and making investigations and accepting the results of those investigations without having to make them fit into a preconceived theory. So he wanted to abolish theoreticism and theoretic science, and I found that quite interesting because we're supposedly conspiracy theorists today, but really what he was interested in is abolishing theory and going only on the results of inquiry and investigation. And he did that very well. And he said, "Let the practice of theorizing be abandoned as one oppressive to the reasoning powers, fatal to the full development of truth, and in every sense inimical to the solid progress of sound philosophy." The term zetetic is derived from the word Greek verb zeteo, which means to search or examine, to proceed only by inquiry, to take nothing for granted, but to trace phenomena to their immediate and demonstrable causes. It is here used in contradistinction from the word theoretic, with the meaning of which is speculative, imaginary, not tangible, scheming, but not proving. So his argument was indeed that the entire globe model that we've been taught is theoretic, and I agree with him that there isn't actually any experiment that you can do in nature from the natural phenomenon to prove we're on a ball, to prove that we're spinning at 1,000 miles an hour in the equator, and that all the other stars that we see in the sky are actually hundreds of trillions of miles away. There is no way of proving that. It's just a theory proposed by Copernicus and later Newton and various other highfalutin scientists who, we've just accepted it and been taught at school and taught ever after that that's the case. And then they worked out their maths based on what they can see, but made them fit into this preconceived theory, which is highly dubious in my understanding. So zetetic inquiry proves the Earth is flat, and there is no simple scientific method to prove that it's spinning as fast as it, or in any way. And there is still no way through inquiry that we can find curvature over the Great Plains and the Great Seas and Oceans of this Earth. So with that introduction, I'll slowly move on to the slideshow. And it's quite a fascinating story, I have to say. I'm completely bowled over by this one. And this is waykiwayki and his YouTube channel, who provided the slideshow for this talk. And he's a great fellow. There he is. Mark and me, a dangerous lot of conspiracy theorists there, walking dogs down the beach. He provided this slideshow, and I've only added a few images to it. So this is the first one. Images like this we've been fed since school. That's not a photo. You know, that's, no one can get that far away to take a photo and say we live there. This is just an image. It's a computer graphic image or it's a painting. Both methods have been employed over the years. And it's just gone into our subconscious, really. So again, it's another one. We're not necessarily there, you know. It's a cool story, but no one can take that photograph. No one ever has been able to. And that's where it all started. Back at school, since the earliest days, it's a globe. The globe is very symbolic of education even. It's traditionally always on the schoolmaster's desk. The first thing you learn, the globe. I was trained as a Montessori teacher, and it makes a big part of the Montessori curriculum. The globe, I mean, yeah, it's the first thing you need to know, isn't it? Where you live, you know. First thing you want to know is the nature of the world we live in. So that's where it starts, with this globe story. And it is just a theory. And it's a theory that presents lots of great problems, because NASA claims these are photos, and if they were photos, you'd expect the size of the continents to sort of match up from one photo to the other. And as you can clearly see here, the North America about two or three times bigger than it is in this image. And no one's been able to explain that satisfyingly. So you have to start to think, what's going on here? It's the same picture, just you can't see. Okay. There's great inconsistencies in all of the images from space. Up until the 90s, it was this one image they used pretty much universally in every magazine, and every image of the Earth would actually just be the same one. In recent years, they brought out more. Certainly from where I'm standing and the entire Flat Earth community, you know, we don't see anything that even looks real there, really. But we've been very much taught it as an absolute fact from the beginning. So it's dubious, and there's lots of good reasons why it's dubious, as we'll go on. A beautiful fake earth indeed. Computer graphic images are, in fact, the main evidence that people will cite. It's like, what? How do you know you live on a globe? Because they've seen it, right? And that's problematic. Oops, sorry. This model here is sort of the most happily pronounced model of what's happening as we're whirling through space-time, spinning on our axis at 1,000 miles an hour, going around the sun at 66,000 miles an hour. Our solar system is supposedly going through the Milky Way at 483,000 miles an hour, and then the Milky Way is going through space at 1.3 million miles an hour, and we can't actually see or feel or even register or measure any of that at all. So it's really difficult for me to look at the night sky now and think that I'm even spinning at any speed. And the consistency with which we see the stars in the same constellations and the same patterns, I mean, you know, this for me is enough. It's just proof that it's a lie, because the stars are always in the same constellations. They don't move around. They're all supposed to be going in different directions through the Milky Way, through space, and we're supposed to be spinning all over the place. And yet you look up and it's just the Bull and the Taurus and Orion's belt just there like it always has been. And it's greatly problematic. This is what we see with a time lapse photography pointing at Polaris, the North Star, which rests continually above the North Pole. And if you set the camera on a time lapse, this is what the stars actually do. They go round and round the North Star. But there's no parallax, there's no movement in between the star's trails. And yet we're supposed to be going, as that image says, all over the place. You know, it's not just us spinning with the North Star above. We're supposed to be moving right around the sun. The North Star is supposed to be 1,000 trillion miles away or something. And it's not what we actually see. It's through logical inquiry and the synthetic method, if you see this star constellation, then you think, well, the stars are clearly moving around the North Star. And the Earth is still. So this is more like what you'd expect to see from my point of view, like a Star Wars hyperdrive. If you're going through space at that kind of speed, the stars would be rushing past you, and they'd move it in their own angles. Yeah, 2,604 trillion miles away, that Polaris star is supposed to be. So if we're moving right around the sun, it would never stay directly above the North Pole, but you'd be hundreds of millions of miles away between summer and winter of any one year. Indeed, this model shows in December at night, we're facing a completely different direction to what we're facing in June at night, and yet we can see the same constellations in the night sky. So for me, you know, that's enough to just like think, well, this idea is a joke then, isn't it? There's another one another demonstration I'd like to do actually with a volunteer. Do we have a couple of volunteers?
Yeah.
Yeah? Would you like to be Earth or the Sun?
Pardon?
Would you like to be the Earth or the Sun?
Sun.
The Sun. Have we got a volunteer to be Earth?
We've
got a volunteer here.
We are right here.
Yeah, if you could come up, please, that would be fantastic. Yeah. Okay. So, you're the Sun.
And I'm Earth.
You're Earth. Now, this is daytime, so you're in Britain, you're facing the Sun. 93 million miles away. Mm-hmm. If you'd like to slowly turn around, yeah, it'll be night time. And you come back and it's daytime again. That's a 24 hour precession and it's midday again and you're facing the Sun. Now in the heliocentric theory, you're moving around as the seasons go by and spinning on your axis just like you did the 24 hour axis. So if you'd like to swap places now, we're 6 months later, facing that direction is still midday because the 24 hour cycle doesn't change. So now in England at midday it's dark, it's pitch black and the sun shines through the midnight. If you've got that, you want to repeat this when you do another turn and another turn, and that's midday again, just like it was all the way around the seasons. The 24 hour loop doesn't change. So in that way you can, it might take a while to get your head around it, but I've thought about that one for a while. It doesn't add up. The rotating orbs don't actually work as a model to match the phenomenon we experience, because the phenomenon we experience is that midday is always sunny, whether it's summer, winter, or autumn. Okay, thank you, our wonderful volunteers.
Beautifully done.
Yes.
It's a strange anomaly here that shooting stars never travel vertically up from below the horizon, and I don't know if you've seen one, but I certainly haven't. On a spinning ball model, they should come in all kinds of directions, and there should be just as many coming up from below the horizon as down. But actually, sometimes you see them go across the top of the sky, but 99% of all stars I've ever seen are actually in a downward motion. And how to explain shooting stars on a flat Earth model, it ends up being a mystery. We don't have data on that really. We have, you know, abstract theories really. Could be all kinds of things. So this comes on to that, you know, this is really the biggest cookie for me. How? Alright. I got taught what a vacuum is. I understand a vacuum basically, conceptually. You need a barrier around a vacuum to stop it from equalizing with the pressure system that's on the outside. You create a vacuum. There's a hole in your vacuum chamber. The air rushes straight in. Has to equalize out. You need an enormous concrete barrier to contain a high-level vacuum, which space is described as a very high-level vacuum. An incredibly powerful vacuum, and there is absolutely no conceivable way in my head that a vacuum of that intensity can just exist next to a non-vacuum atmosphere. There would need to be a reinforced steel concrete barrier going around our Earth.
You'd have to have like a thermos flask, a double skin.
Yeah, double skin thermos flask going around the Earth, you know, and then that would be problematic because the sun wouldn't get through. So, Marky, my mate Mark, put more hours into this. He phoned up a number of scientists to ask this question, and they couldn't answer it. They got quite upset. And you know, if you work it out, if you can find an answer to this one, please do let me know. You know, the whole process of this is not to stick to my theory unless it's based on solid evidence. And I'd in some ways be quite happy to go back to living on a globe. You know, people would start thinking I'm so weird. But how do you explain that? It's really quite a toughie. So I believed we were a pressurized spinning ball at 1,000 miles next to a vacuum until I heard myself say it. Yeah, there's some comedy memes in here. I couldn't resist. Hang on, I'm in between opposing pressure systems. We do have a laugh, and I wanted to say that's how it all works. I kind of wanted to explain a little bit of the psychology of the flat earth movement, because it's famous for giving people a hard time on Facebook and getting upset ourselves, maybe, and making jokes like this, you know, about very serious matters. And it is because the entire flat earth movement, you know, as we've come to see, is based on repeatable scientific experiment and logical inquiry. A logical inquiry of the vacuum, it's a logical inquiry. And there have been no serious answers come back from any of the major scientists, astrophysicists of our day, which, considering the growth of the movement in the last few years and how much everyone just hates it, one of these big astrophysicist guys would come down and school us and tell us why it's all so wrong. You know, but they haven't, and there's been no serious answers to any of the very serious questions. It's just been a lot of irate people calling us stupid. So, as a result, you know, we get creative and make jokes like this. Gravity is, best of my knowledge, always been a theory and never been proven. They say they've proven it, but the experiments look highly dubious, to say the least. And we have no practical experience of objects being attracted to each other in the way that they propose. So it's just been a theory created to try and keep the heliocentric Bohr model rolling. And it's been replaced in our scientific understanding by a basic concept of density, that dense objects fall and light objects rise. And that's all you really need to know. The objects themselves aren't necessarily attracted to each other. This I took off a scientific paper today. This is explaining that gravity counters the centrifugal force of a spinning ball. We all know when a ball is spinning, anything that's on the edge of it will fly off. A wet tennis ball spinning round, and what will fly off? Because of centrifugal force. And gravity is meant to counter the centrifugal force. All fine and good, you know, so we're spinning around at 1,000 miles an hour, and gravity counters the centrifugal force, and we feel absolutely nothing. Like up here, you know, we're supposedly spinning around right now, you know, 1,000 miles an hour. Well, not at 1,000 miles an hour, as my point would be. The gravity force is constant, as tall. The Earth is the same size, I'm the same size, so the pressure, the gravitational pressure holding me down, is a constant. However, the centrifugal force will vary enormously, because at the equator it's spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, but necessarily in the northern and southern hemispheres, the speed will slow right down. So the centrifugal force will be much greater on the outer extremities of the Earth, where the gravity remains constant. Thereby, if you're on the northern hemisphere, you'd be plastered to the floor because the gravity would be so strong and there wouldn't be enough centrifugal force to counter it. Or, alternatively, you know, if you're on the equator, you'd feel lighter and you'd be able to jump up higher or even fly off. So this is the mainstream explanation, that the gravity counters a centrifugal force. But through logical inquiry, through zetetic inquiry, we know that the centrifugal force will vary as the speed varies. Gravity is constant. So we'd have to feel a completely different amount of pressure in the northern hemispheres than we would on the equator. And, you know, no one's got an answer. That's what I've been asking. No one's got an answer to these questions. So you have to conclude that the Earth isn't a ball, in my opinion. This is the Dark Rift, the Milky Way, as it's known, but also known as the Dark Rift. It's supposed to be the centre of the galaxy. But, you know, that's just what it is. We don't know how far away those lights are. And in ancient mythology, this Dark Rift is actually seen to be a crack in the dome, which the source of new suns, floods, all kinds of things. It's actually considered quite malevolent or freaky in lots of different ancient cosmologies. The Dark Rift was what place of action and to be feared. But we're told it's the Milky Way and everyone's quite happy. This is, it seems to be cut off a little bit at the top and bottom, I'm not quite sure why, but the spherical trigonometry is the basic hard maths and science that enables us to have some confidence of what we're talking about. And this guy Mullin's a great physicist with his own Balls Out YouTube channel. And again, I'm not a great mathematician. I wouldn't have been able to work these formulas out. I mean, it's done on Excel and AutoCAD, but it's the same formula as Robotham was using in 1850. And no one's come and said it's wrong. There's been no mathematician come and said, look, that's not how you measure a curve. I've known one mathematician who was in the room and he looked at it and he did his own calculations and worked it out to be so. Agreed with the basic maths. So we've all been taught exactly the size of the ball. You can look any encyclopedia or science manual. And therefore there's an absolutely solid equation to work out the curvature. And the curvature at 10 miles is 67 feet. At 1 mile, it's just 8 inches. But as you go along, the miles get squared, 8 inches per squared mile. So at 10 miles, there's 67 feet of curvature in this model. Now, I've been down a beach, I'm sure you all have, and seen a little harbour 10 miles away. The boat's bobbing in the harbour, you shouldn't be able to see them, because they're 11 metres under the curve, 67 feet. I'm not sure if it's 11 metres, 67 feet. It's impossible physics. There's nothing there that you can measure that of any degree of curvature, and some of the photos of islands like 100 miles away, you know, which is like 6,000 feet of curvature, and you can still see the topography of the island as if you're looking over a straight plane. No one's countered this equation. No one's come and said, actually, the ball's 30,000 miles radius, and so it should be a tenth of that, which would create other problems. So it just stands as this enormous invisible curvature, and we go out curvature hunting all the time with zoom cameras, and you can't find it. You can do a laser test over a lake and see that it's flat. And this is Rowbotham, who wrote this book in the 1850s, and he did a series of experiments such as this one in the Bedford Canal. He put flags of the same height over 6 miles. He did it in a number of different ways. I've just got one of his diagrams. And get his telescope out, and over 6 miles, I think it was like 16 foot of curvature or something that would have to be visible, and there was no curvature visible. No one's debunked any of this stuff yet, so it's flat, as far as I'm concerned. This is an image from a high altitude weather balloon that I had up rolling earlier. Higher you get, doesn't matter how high you get this flat, lovely plane and a dark sky, peculiarly without seeing the stars. No one really knows why or why not. You kind of can't see the stars in these pictures. But there's been a whole host of weather balloons go up and picture both the sun and the moon at the same time, hot spots under the sun. You can't really see a clear hot spot here, but this thing's supposed to be 93 million miles away, and the sunlight's rays would actually hit parallel from that distance. This is a first photograph taken from scientists called Space in the 40s, and a friend of mine put this up just the other day, and just for historical sake. Altitude of 65 miles, and you still can't see curvature. Now, this is problematic because most people think they've seen the curvature because the boats go over the horizon, right? And that's a trick of perspective. If there was enough curvature to see a boat drop over the horizon, then there'd be enough curvature for you to actually see the curve. But the way the boats disappear at a distance is due to the water density and the atmospheric conditions over the sea that you actually see them at. And even just looking over any straight surface, such as a tabletop, and you take a coin along that surface, and the bottom starts to disappear due to the way the light hits into the eyeball. And there's a lot of great work being done on that. This shows the hot spot a little bit more underneath the sun. You know, that was 93 million miles away. There shouldn't be more sunlight there than there. There really shouldn't. More pictures of a flat Earth. Doesn't matter whether it's a sea or a city. The weary word, horizon, horizontal, obviously the same route. And here comes the trickery. This is a very famous Red Bull stunt a few years ago, very highly funded. Red Bull have obviously got a bit of financial backing. But this is him when he was leaving the thing for the jump, and you can see it's flat. And then they come out and they just get the fisheye lens and go get the GoPro and turn it into a ball again. So a lot of the nicest images of the Earth from space will just be a flat one, and then they just put it in a fisheye lens and then it looks a bit curved. One of many bridges around the world that are enormously long with no engineered curvature into them. As a lot of engineers have gone on record and said to allow for curvature in the engineering of a major railway or a canal would just be absolutely berserk, and they just don't, and they never have done. So if you can see ships sail over the horizon, you wouldn't be able to see a flat horizon from a high altitude. What do you mean by flat talk? Yeah, I put these comedy memes in just, you know, it's a bit of a laugh now these days. We try and have fun. This is done by Mark himself, his view from the south of Spain. You can see the land there in the distance. That shouldn't be visible with the curvature at all. And this is what happens. This is from a video. So you think the boat's going over the horizon and it's gone. And then you can bring, this is the boy here, with a good zoom lens, all those boats that have disappeared over the horizon come back into view. Sometimes with some little effects on the bottom of the hull. But this is a pilot who got very upset when she said plane pilots would have to be dipping their nose continually as they're flying over the earth, and a few of them have been caught off guard and said, no, we don't dip the nose. And then we say, well, you're on a flat plane then. And it's like, no, we're not on a flat plane. We just don't dip our nose. Very problematic. Because the Coriolis effect that we've all been taught is that the atmosphere and the things in the atmosphere are actually independent of the Earth's spin. This is the Coriolis effect. We've been taught this. That if you fire a bullet, you've got to fire it to one side because it's going to spin off because it's not held to the Earth's spin. It doesn't make any sense. Because if the Coriolis effect was true, then landing one of these planes, if you're moving independently from the Earth's spin, you've got to land a plane on a spinning ball. That would be highly dangerous, and all runways would have to be perfectly east-west. And they're not. So if you're landing a plane, you know, south-north on a runway, and the ball is moving, it would just flop over and crash and burn. Moving on to satellites here, I think. Is this radar technology. Again, it works on a flat plane. The radar beams wouldn't be able to curve around the globe, but they're employed regularly as such. These are different experiments that have supposedly proven the Earth's curvature, the Foucault pendulum, and this was the Cavendish experiment where he's trying to measure the attraction between these two balls. They've been debunked. The Foucault pendulum, I can't remember what they're saying now. It does vary in its thing, in its swing. But it doesn't actually prove that the Earth is moving, because it would actually move around like that anyway. I've seen a big one in the Science Museum and looked at it, and it doesn't convince me at all. And there's lots of anomalies in the recorded data. They did champion it as proof of the spinning globe, but for me, there would have to be a lot stronger evidence. And the Cavendish experiment here, I saw a documentary about that, and it's a complete joke. The guy was a joker, and he's measuring it on like fractions of light, and it was just entirely unconvincing, the whole story about Mr. Cavendish and his experiment. It sounded like a complete joke. But from these two experiments, they deduce that that's where we live. I think it's a big leap of faith. Such is this model. We've only ever actually drilled 10 miles down the surface, yet they tell us there's all of this going on. There's no actual inquiry you can make scientific experiment that will provide you with the result of this. It's just a theory, but it's a theory that's been rammed in our faces through National Geographic. You know, gravity is supposed to be holding this bad boy on the sea in Australia.
Yeah, I like,
you know,
Australia.
And it's problematic, isn't it? Really? Is it the gravity were so strong to hold not only the ocean but the ocean liner onto the Earth, then why would we feel this lightness of motion and the birds fly and everything floats around? You know, if I was next to that boat, surely the force would be so great you're just plastered to the bloody Earth. I mean, theoretically, you might be able to give a loose explanation, but it just doesn't add up to me at all. I think the whole thing's a bloody joke. Yeah, water flies off a spinning ball, you know. I don't know why, if you just suddenly scale it up, everything changes. But our experience of phenomena is that a spinning object will throw everything off of it. And these gravity cases, it's just looking weak. Now, the tides are supposed to be caused by the gravitational attraction of the moon. Now, gravity is supposed to be accumulative. The closer you get, the stronger the force is. So, if it starts pulling the waters towards it, if the moon starts pulling the water towards it, then the force of gravity would increase slightly, and then it would pull it towards it more. So what you'd end up happening is the water would get so close and get a stronger gravitational force, so close, there's nothing to stop it flying off and hitting the moon. I don't think anyone can explain that, really. I mean, if it's pulling the water off, then why didn't it all just fly off and hit the moon? Oh, because the Earth's gravity is stronger. Well, if the Earth's gravity is stronger, why ain't the moon flying towards the Earth and smashing into the Earth? The moon's gravitational attraction as the cause of the tides is problematic for other reasons, because the large lakes, inland lakes on this Earth, show absolutely no movement due to the gravitational attraction of the moon. And then the ocean's tides vary enormously, even in Britain. And there's not a lot of solid data on what is causing the tides, but that's fine with me. I don't mind not knowing particularly. There's theories, but it's difficult to prove them at the moment without further trips to the North Pole. And the moon causing the tides through gravitational attraction just looks like a joke shop to me, because yeah, either the moon would fly into the Earth or all the water would fly off and hit the moon. Fly into Australia. Yeah, a lot of mathematical theories. They base the maths on stuff they can observe. So they take the angles that you can observe of the planets and the sun and the moon, and then they work backwards and create a whole heap of formula. And then if the formula works, then they think they've proven it. And as a matter of fact, you know, you've got to stick to what you can observe. So their mathematical model does make sense mathematically, because they've taken the data firsthand and then produced all the maths. But then they plug it into a theory which is completely extraneous to our senses. The moon causing the eclipse is highly implausible in the heliocentric model that it just happens to be exactly 400 times smaller and the Sun exactly 400 times further away, that they're the same size. But in the basic flat Earth model, they're the same size anyway, so it kind of makes a bit more sense. This is how light would reach us from 93 million miles away in parallel lines. By the time we're this far away from the Sun, there'd be no none of this going on. The Sun's crepuscular rays prove to a logical inquirer, in my mind, that the source of the light is where all those rays come together. And it's just there. If the Sun were 93 million miles away, then the rays would hit the Earth parallel. And then the scientific models say it's due to refraction. And that doesn't really add up to me, because the they'd still be hitting the atmosphere everywhere and then refracting. They wouldn't just hit here and refract. So the crepuscular rays very much proved to me, to a logical inquirer, that the Sun is indeed close and literally above the clouds. More shots of the crepuscular rays. I mean, I've seen this for myself, I'm sure we all have. In any other circumstance, you would say that the source of the light is at the sum total of where those rays go to. Small, close Sun above the clouds, shining down on the flat Earth. Sorry. Okay. What you see could well be indeed the reality. It's a basic sketch of the flat Earth model there. These are the different distances of the Sun over the years. Different people have worked it out to be 3 million miles away, 13, 16,592, because all they've got to measure is some kind of light wave and then guess, you know, and so they've changed their mind. This is what happens with perspective, that two things the same distance converge, and at a certain distance they'll become one. I believe the Sun there to be very high above the railway track, but of course as it goes further and further away it all goes towards the horizon. And this is an experiment you can do with a coin. This explains the Sun setting, that you can get your eye level over the table. I did it this afternoon actually for fun. As the coin gets further away over a level plane, the bottom starts to get cut off. And this is exactly what's happening with the Sun in the flat Earth model. Another thing happens, that through the water hanging in the air, the Sun can appear to enlarge, because it's literally magnified by suspended water in the air. If you see a sunset in a very dry desert area, you can actually see the Sun get smaller and smaller as it hits the horizon. But as we tend to see it set over the ocean, it gets this sort of magnification at the end as well, and produces all kinds of beautiful tricks of light, and looks like it's setting, but it's actually just flying off into the distance. Pictures of the Moon from the northern and southern hemisphere show it rotated upside down, and I haven't travelled extensively since this story to have a look, but as you gradually go south, the Moon's face gradually turns, and it's a very beautiful thing, but it's very difficult to explain on the heliocentric model. This is what the Moon would look like if it was actually reflecting sunlight, if it was a sphere of rock. I've never known a sphere to not have this effect when light is shone on it. And the Moon is not only an even light all over it, but it's tremendously bright as well all over it. And the quality of the light is distinct to sunlight. See, this is Tycho. Oh, this, the crater here, 52 miles wide, 240,000 miles away. We shouldn't be able to see stuff like that because the human eye has very distinct limits on how far it can see. This is absolutely hilarious. I mean, this is like, it's just game over for the space missions for me. Like all of this, you know, even if it's a ball, they've still faked space because you can't get anomalous data like this. You know, this is supposed to be the Earth from the Moon. That's supposed to be the Moon in front of the Earth. How can you be sailing on there and getting this in the distance? That's, you know, that's what it maybe should look like. That's the size of the Moon from the Earth, not the size of the Earth from the Moon. The Moon's supposed to be a hell of a lot smaller than the Earth. And that's some nice studio lights in Stanley Kubrick's bloody Hollywood basement. Water always finds its level. It's just another simple experiment we can all do anywhere. It doesn't hold a curve. It holds a level no matter what its container is. It will always level out. The rivers always flow down into the sea. I can't get my head around the rivers on the globe model, but many people have said on the globe model the sea would have to go up the rivers and it would go all over the place, but I just can't really get my head around the globe model at all. On a flat model it's pretty easy, the rivers just go down and out into the sea, but in a spinning ball going all over the place with humps and curves, the water would be rushing up and down them. I don't know, I can't work it out. What makes more sense? Water lies level, it can't hold a curve, it would fly off a spinning ball anyway. You know, there's a million ways to show these things. And I think this is a satellite collection now, yeah? So satellites are a good one, it's a good one people bring up. What about the satellites? I've certainly never seen a real satellite. I've never even seen a real picture of a satellite. When you search for a real picture of a satellite, you get computer graphic images of satellites. And then you look at satellite dishes, and they're horizontal, which is just really funny. Because they are indeed, no doubt, pointing straight at terrestrial communications masts, not up to the sky. They should all be on the roof, pointing up. This is the source of our communications, along with underground cables. Almost undoubtedly. The antenna on the top of all the skyscrapers, the huge boom for skyscrapers. And if you've got the highest tower in any city, urban area or country, and you've got a big mast at the top, then you've got the best communications system and the furthest reaching. And knowledge is power, communications is key for business. So there's a good economic incentive to build skyscrapers, and that's a good reason why they probably did build so many when there's not other economic reasons. I mean, there's status reasons for sure, but they'll all have massive antenna on the top. And
the economic reason for skyscrapers is because of you're building up instead of building out, so you're taking up less space because you're building up. That's the economic
reason. It's very true, yeah. There's you're building up and property price is high, but you know, America's a big place, there's a lot of space.
Not to stick an antenna on,
and
it's to provide space for people.
Provide office space, yeah.
Whatever. whatever.
I mean, I can't verify it. I wasn't there.
It costs you millions and millions and millions of pounds just to stick an antenna on the top, are you?
No, well, you get to use the building as well, but it would be an extra incentive.
No, that's what the
listen, there was no great demand for office space, I've heard, when the World Trade Centers go up. So I can't verify I wasn't there in the 70s being an office worker.
Up on a pole, wouldn't you? Like,
well, there are many, many just communication poles. Flag poles. From the Canary Islands. Yeah. So it's a new one. So, our satellites, new one to me. I've seen this footage of the video footage of these balloons taking up objects like this, which do actually look like satellites. And this is a Google project, I think Google Loon, to take up pretty much like satellite communication devices with hot air balloons. I don't know why they'd bother if there's 20,000 satellites already up there. But this is Dubai, and these communications masts in the sea covering our communications needs quite neatly alongside all the massive underground ocean cables that they've been laying, such as these, and there's massive fat cables running under all the seas providing communication. So there's no need for 15,000 satellites to be flying around the Earth, and there's very little evidence of them. It's just Tata Communications bragging about their underground cable systems. And this is Google own a fleet of planes. And actually, all of Google Earth images that we see are like this. And there's no need for any of these to be taken by satellites, because this level of resolution could quite easily be provided by an aeroplane. And then you zoom out and it turns into a computer graphic. So this is how many satellites there's supposed to be flying around the Earth, and yet we never hear of any of them crashing into each other, never hear of them, any of them crashing into the International Space Station. They never seem to just fall out of the sky.
Good timing.
That was a satellite! Hilariously.
It's a flying saucer.
Yeah, it's a flying saucer. That's true, it's a flying saucer. That's a good one. I've got some paranormal activity going on in there. Magic cafe. Yeah. Yeah, there's another thing about the whole fake space, you know, like, in a vacuum, I'm trying to work out why the bottom of this is cut off, but I think in the middle of it now. In a vacuum, what are you pushing against? How do your rockets work? How does the vacuum not suck all the fuel out of your jets? And you know, what's going to provide propulsion in a vacuum? Very, very confusing and very unexplained at best. I don't believe it's there at all, so it's sort of easier. Can't stop, can't speed, steer, can't measure speed in a vacuum. Rockets. These are great pictures, I have to say. all the rockets they've launched do this, and I've seen video after video after video of rockets going up and across, and then it's on long enough they start dipping down again, and they were mostly set off from Florida into the Bermuda Triangle. So at what point that's supposed to get to this mythical altitude in between being sucked into a vacuum and pulled back down to Earth, where suddenly it's hunky-dory and you can just keep on going round and round forever? it's utterly mind-boggling. It's inconceivable. As is the moon landing. So I'm a favourite. You know, there are still people who believe that we went to moon in the 60s. I remember reading for quite a long time ago, like, people were busting this as fake for a while and explaining that they faked it to win the Cold War against Russia. So there's different reasons why they could have faked it. Now I understand they fake it just to maintain this heliocentric globe Earth deception.